Just suck in the Spirit of God. The Bible tells us that when we praise Him, that He inhabits our praises. So right now, He is surrounding us. Just breathe Him in. Oh, man, just take Him in just for a second. Some of us need to take a real long, deep breath because we need a lot of God this morning. Amen to that. I know that I do. Man, I know we all do. The awesome thing that He inhabits our praises, and then it says that when we pray that we inhabit His throne room, so we open up the door for Him to come, and then He's right here for when we pray. So that's why we pray right after, because then God's with us, so He's right there. So it's real easy to be able to talk to Him. You see, it's not like there's a ceiling above us, because God's not above the ceiling. He's actually inside of here. Okay? Some of us, we think when we pray that our ceiling just hit a wall. You ever been there? You ever think that you pray and it's just like, it just doesn't get up there to Him? It just doesn't get there to Him. But that's the awesome thing. So many of us, we need to start our prayer time with a little bit of praise to God. You see, most of the time we just go in and we say, God, this is what I need. No wonder it feels like your prayers are just hitting that ceiling. Because the first thing you go is, I need, I need, I need. Instead of going, God, you know how awesome you are? Do you know how great you are? You see, how did Jesus start the prayer? With praising God. Again, hallowed be your name. How holy is your name? How great is your name? How wonderful is your name? You see, right there, He started praising Him, and God goes, okay, I'm here. I'm here. I'm in your praises. So that's how we need to start our prayer. Start your prayer time next time with a little bit of, God, wow, you are amazing. You have helped me through this. You have done this. Even if you feel like He's not there, you still say, God, I know you're there somewhere, and you're awesome in whatever you're doing. You are working in some avenue of my life that I can't even see, and you're great for doing that. Start with a little praise for Him. This morning we had a few people that were added to our list. 5 nursery students, nursing students were added. The Holcombs, which is my sister and brother-in-law and their kids, they have been constantly under Satan's attack. From sickness to surgeries to everything else, and now my sister is sick, has fluid in her lungs. So if you guys would, please be praying for them. Nancy Walters, Tressa Miller. Is there anybody else that needs to be added to the prayer list this morning? Go ahead. Okay. Put Jen on there for her sugar test. Kevin and Clyde. If you guys would pray for them. Anybody else? They're going to be going into MB region, which is a pretty remote area in Papua New Guinea. If you guys don't know where Papua New Guinea, there's Australia, and then right here is Papua New Guinea. It's pretty much just a bushland. There's still a lot of spiritual warfare, stuff like that going on. They believe in witchcraft and all that kind of stuff. So he'll be going into kind of the heart of that area, into really a deep part of the bush. So if you guys would be praying for Benji. Anything else, guys? Guys, be praying for Jose. Mm-hmm. That's definitely a praise right there. See, I guess around here, we kind of believe in divine appointment to where we have been praying that individuals would come. So if you guys are here, it's not by chance. It's actually because we've been praying that you would be here. If you're here specifically just for today, it's not by chance. It's because we've been praying that you would come on a specific day that you need. And I think some of the people that are members here, they would say that there are people coming out of divine appointment because we don't invite you. We haven't invited you. Nobody has spoken to you about coming. You just felt like you should come. So that's definitely the power of the prayer. And some of you specifically, we have been praying for that you would come. Maybe that you would come back, and we are grateful for it. Anything else? Tell her thank you. She's a very smart lady.
I know.
Anything else? Chase, I saw your hand. What's up, man? Alex Keith, Matthew Wheeler, and Hunter Adams. Hunter Ash. Okay. It's always a praise. Just that God, he's in it. Even when we mess up sometimes, even when I mess up sometimes, that God's still in it. That's awesome. If we're obedient to him, he's still in it. Anything else, guys? Thank you for that, Ann. He definitely is. Amen to that. Anything else? Go ahead. Okay. Guys, if you put Robin on there, that would be great. Anything else? If not, let's pray. Father, I thank you for your presence. Thank you for how great and amazing that you truly are. Even when we turn our backs, even when we turn away from you, Father, that you are still there. That you still love us. That you still want to be a part of our lives. Father, I just pray that you would continue to do what you're doing up here, and that you would guide all of us into the direction that you want us to go, and that we would come to realize that, as Ann said, that you're the best friend that we could ever have, that even when we act like we can't stand you, God, you're still there. Even when we question what you're doing, that you're still there and you're still faithful. God, there are so many names on the list right now. Names that desperately need your touch. Names that desperately need your physical touch, God. And we know that you can do it. Father, we come with you with pure faith. Not with a little bit of faith, but with pure faith, Father. That you would touch those that need it. That you would touch those that need a physical healing, Father, because we have them. We have a lot of them that need your touch. God, that you would be with us. Be with us the rest of this service. Be with me. My words be with these people's ears, their hearts, their minds, their thoughts. Just their actions, God, that they would listen to what it is you want them to hear. That each individual would hear the message specific for them. That they would hear what you want to say, not what I want to say. God, I just pray that we can humble ourselves, that we can swallow our pride and accept what you're telling us. Father, I thank you so much for your obedience, so much for your love, so much for your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our tithes and offerings. Yeah. Annabelle, would you ask a blessing on this offering? This time, Mandy is going to take the junior church, so ages 3 to 9. And while they're leaving, do we have any testimonies? Or any special music? Okay, Josh?
All right, guys, you want to go ahead and get out your Bibles. And we're going to start it off again with some manly stuff. So women, if you want to close your ears, that would probably be great, because I'm going to read three of some of the most disturbing verses in the Bible. I'm telling you, probably aren't preached about a whole lot, but they're in there. You guys know I usually find these things that people go, that's not in there, and it really is. So just to let you know, these things are going to be very graphic. These are manly things. As men, we love blood and fights and stuff like that. So that's kind of what we're gonna talk about this morning. Not really talk about, but that's at least what I'm going to read first thing off. So it might not be funny, but it's definitely going to be manly. Okay? All right, women, I'm telling you, you can close your ears if you want to. Some of our teens, they're already smiling because they know some of the stuff that I'm going to talk about because we've talked about it before. All right, 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 23 through 24. You don't have to flip there because I'm going to go real fast and we're not going to do a whole lot of study on it. But it says, this makes me think of John Walters. From there, Elisha went up to Bethel. As he was walking along the road, some boys came out of town and jeered at him and said, get out of here, Baldy. They said, get out of here, Baldy. He turned around, looked at them, called down a curse on them in the name of the Lord. Suddenly, two bears came out of the woods and mauled 42 of the boys. Instantly, bears came out, mauled, and killed 42 of the boys. Okay? It's in there. I just told you the scripture. Okay. Jumping over to Judges, chapter 19, verse 27. We're going to start there. When her master got up in the morning and opened the door at the house and stepped out to continue on his way, there lay his concubine, fallen in the doorway of the house with her hands on the threshold. He said to her, "Get up, let's go." But there was no answer. Then the man put her on his donkey and set out for home. When he reached home, he took a knife, cut up his concubine limb by limb into 12 parts, and sent them into all the areas of Israel. It's in there. And now we get into the ones that the boys, they love this one. And I think, yes, definitely is a round of applause for us boys. Okay. Judges chapter 4, verse 20 and 21. This is, if you guys have a photographic or a visual memory or a visual mind, you probably don't want to listen to this. "Stand in the doorway of the tent," he told her. "If somebody comes by and asks you, 'Is anyone there?' say no." But Jael, Heber's wife, picked up a tent peg and a hammer, went quietly to him while he lay fast asleep, exhausted. Suddenly she drove the tent peg through his temple and into the ground. Guys, you can clap for that one. That is some gruesome stuff. That's manly stuff, right? Sorry, I just had a we have to do something manly every Sunday, so that's our manly thing, was gruesome this week. But when I taught some of those things to the teens, that was like their most exciting week that they ever had, especially for the boys, to hear about gruesome stuff in the Bible. Because most of the time we're up here, and it is. That's why we're doing this month, because church has got so, you gotta watch what you say, and it's become real feminine. The church has become really feminine. And that's not the way that's supposed to be, right? Jesus didn't say, upon this tutu, I will build my church. He said, upon this rock, I will build my church. And so it just goes that we should be still manly, okay? Now, I'm not saying we don't have dead animals, I mean, just floating with guts out here, okay? We've kind of kept it a little nice, but we need to focus on the men. And so that's what we're doing this month. And so last week, if you weren't here, you've realized that it looks a little different in here. But this morning, what we're going to talk about is the fact that real men are not religious. And most of you are probably going, what are you talking about? Real men are not religious. The reason that I say that is because a poll was taken, and it is said that 80% of Americans claim to be Christian. How many people find that hard to believe? You better believe that I do. If 80% of Americans were Christian, can we explain why the porn industry is so huge? I doubt that only the 20% that aren't Christian are part of that. Can we explain why the divorce rate is just, whoa, it's just going crazy, and divorce after divorce after divorce after divorce? Can it explain why there's still so many people committing crimes, that there's so much hurt, that there's so much murder? I doubt that only the 20% of the people that aren't Christian are the ones that are doing all this stuff. And you see, it all comes back, because I've told you before, it comes back on us men. And the fact of it is that out of those 80% that are men, they're not really Christians. Okay? Today I want you to think, am I really a Christian man? Last week we talked about the men that God wants to make us. So this week we're going to talk about, are we really a Christian man? Because the problem is that most men have become religious. And see, when I say that, when we make Christianity into religion, we kind of make it like a Jesus buffet line, where we can go through and we can pick and choose the verses that we want to believe, and then we can pick and choose the verses that we don't want to believe. That's when we make it religion. That we can pick out verses that make us look and feel wonderful, but then we can decide to decline on the verses that maybe make us feel bad and not really that good of a person. Okay? You guys following me here? Yes, I know some of this stuff might be hard to swallow this morning, but man up, swallow it, take it. We need one of them translators. Thanks, Clyde. I'll try to make one, man. But see, when we become a religious man, you see, we can pick out verses. Let's say, let's go off a divorce. I just said divorce. Let's go off a divorce. You see, we, if we've never been divorced, we can stand upon that foundation that God hates divorce, and you should have never been divorced, because we don't look bad in that, right? We look good. No, I've been with my wife for years and years and years, even though you guys can't stand each other, and she wants to shoot you. But, you know, we've been together for years. Or put a tent peg through your temple. But we've been together for years. You know, we pick out things like that. Or maybe we become a Christian, and we're not gay. So you know what? We get on the gay bashing bandwagon. We say, you know, God hates all gays, and he hates... But see, when God actually still loves that individual, he might not love the sin that they're in, but guess what? He doesn't like yours either. Okay? Bible doesn't specify that there's any variations in sin, okay? You tell a lie, and if you're a man and sleep with another man, guess what? Same sin. Same sin. Or as a religious man, you know, we might be real quick to point out that the Bible says that evil comes, you know, from the love of money, and the root of all evil is from the love of money, and we like to underline that love part, that we really don't love our money, we just like it, and money makes the world go round. When actually, if you talk to every single American in here, which most of us are, right? Everybody an American? You love money. Let's just put it real flat. You love money. You like to have it. When you don't have it, you're upset. When you do have it, you're wonderful, right? We love money. But we want to point out that, it just says that the love of money. It doesn't, you know, I don't love my money. Well, yeah, you do love your money. But see, what we should do as Christians, as real Christians, not as just religious men, you see, we should go to the divorced, or we should go to the individual that's maybe in their second marriage and say, you know what? Jesus wants to be in your marriage. Maybe he wasn't in your first one, but he wants to be in your second one. You see, he wants to be number one in your relationship. You see, he wants you to look towards him. When you can't stand that other person and you want to drive a tent peg through their temple, he wants you to look towards him and go, God, I don't know how to love him anymore. You got to give me something inside. You got to fix me. You got to make my eyes look to what is wonderful in this person. You see, if we were real Christian men, we'd go to the gay man and just explain how the power of the blood of Jesus has set us free from so many sins. And guess what? It can do the same thing to you. It can do the same thing to you. But a lot of us don't want to do that, because guess what? We still have a lot of sin. We still have those things in the back pocket. Maybe I don't want to go there. Or we can get to the fact that when we're a Christian man, we can realize that God just doesn't want to bless us. He wants to bless through us. When we get to the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, you know, that kind of stuff. No, we need to realize that God is only blessing us so that we can bless somebody else. And that's the bottom line. So we can give it away. You see, I've found in my life that when God fills me up, you know why he does that? Because he wants me to pour it out on somebody else. He wants me to empty it out on somebody else. And see, that's the same thing here. But see, we've become a religion. We haven't became a way of life. You see, there's a big difference there. Is because has Jesus really became a way of life? Has Christianity became a way of life for you men? Is he number one? Is he your example? Most likely not. It's became a religion where we just say, yes, we believe in God, we are Christians, and that is wonderful enough. Well, guess what? That's not wonderful enough. Titus chapter 1, verse 16. Thanks, sir. Makes it easy on me. Titus chapter 1, verse 16 says, they claim to know God, but by their actions they deny him. They are detestable, disobedient, unfit for doing anything good. Does that sound like some people that I just described? Sounds like a religious guy, doesn't it? Where we think, oh, there's this certain list that we do. You know, we look really good, and you know, we've cleaned up our act a little bit. But see, by their actions, they deny him, because we're not out there telling other people how much Jesus loves them. How much you hate him, that he still loves you. The fact that no matter how deep and dark you are into sin, that guess what? He can still release you from it. Anybody tell anybody that? I mean, we're all guilty of that, right? I mean, it's okay. You don't have to say yes, because I know. They claim to know him, but by their actions, they deny him. Could you imagine thinking that you are detestable? That you are disgusting? That you can't do anything good. backslide. At least we got some honest people in here. I like it. Let's move on, Matthew chapter 7. Because guess what? If that describes you, so does this. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons and perform many miracles. This is Jesus talking. Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. You see right there, I think it's great that Jesus doesn't say that, I never saw what you did. Okay, Jesus, I saw what you did. Wonderful, two thumbs up. But the fact that I never knew you, you see, there was no relationship there. You see, Jesus wants a real relationship. You see, the 12 disciples that he picked, they were messed up guys, okay? He didn't pick the best. Ooh, no. He picked people that the world would thought was detestable. All right, think about the most nasty and disgusting job that anybody could have in the world right now. You might know somebody that does that job. Guess what? Jesus would probably pick them for his disciple. Matthew, he was a tax collector. Nobody liked them. You guys don't like people taking your money. Guess what? That's what he did. People couldn't stand him. He was nasty and disgusting in his time. And guess what? Jesus told him, come on, you can be one of mine. See, guys, this is serious stuff here, all right? We can't just claim to be Christians. There's 80% of Americans that claim to be Christians. I would hate to know the percentage that this is going to happen to. I'm thinking it's probably going to be pretty large. Looking at our world right now, it's probably going to be pretty big. If 80% of Americans say that they are a Christian, and the world still looks the way that it does, I hope not. Let's move on, Colossians chapter 2. You see, Paul gives us a warning here about the fact of human tradition, because so many things that we do, even inside of the church, outside of the church, they have become just tradition. It's not that it's actually scripture that says to do it, it's just became tradition. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the basic principles of this world, rather than on Christ. See, I've told this story before. I'll tell it again. I grew up United Methodist. There's a United Methodist church. The pastor at the time, they had got brand new carpet in. And when they would take communion, the first couple times that they took it, the pastor was actually shocking people because of the new carpet. Because they came up and they took the communion right out of his hand, okay? And so he was actually shocking people. And so what he did, there was an electric heater on the side of the church. And so before communion, he would go over, he would touch the heater just to shock it, you know, shock himself. And then he'd come over and he'd do communion. Well, he did that for years. And all of a sudden, the pastor retired and he went away and this new young guy came. And new young pastor, real vibrant and everything else, and he did communion. After the service, one of the elders came up and said, you did a great job, but you did communion wrong. Pastor kind of went, oh, okay. And the elder didn't elaborate on it or anything and just went on. Well, this happened for a couple months, and every time he'd do it, the elder would say, you're just not doing it right. So finally, it irked this kid so much that he called up the old pastor and said, what about communion am I not doing wrong? And so they talked about it a little bit, and they couldn't really figure it out. So the next time he asked the elder, he said, then what am I doing wrong with communion? He said, you're not going over and touching the heater. Guys, this is a true story. You're not going over and touching the heater. You see, it had become such a tradition that the pastor would go over and touch the heater and then give communion that the people thought that that was part of what was supposed to happen. That's how easily we are taken over. That's how easily the veil comes over our head, where we think, no, that's a holy heater right there. If you guys want healing, just bow at the heater. That thing will take care of it. But that's how easy it is. You see, it's became human tradition instead of actually what the Bible says. You see, I've always told you, I want a messed up church. That has been my prayer since day one, since we've been here. I want a messed up church full of messed up people. Because guess what? You got a messed up pastor. And we have it. I love it. We got some messed up people here. Because your leader is messed up. You guys know that. I'm messed up. The way I think about things is distorted. It's messed up. Sorry, God made me this way. God put me through the things that I was supposed to go to. Romans chapter 9, if you don't believe that, it says that God creates objects of wrath that he can show mercy to. Guess what? I was an object of wrath. I was under drug addiction and everything else for years and years and years. And God truly, he had his hand on me, but he kept my face down in that mud so I could just continue to go through it so that when I came out, I could talk to people that have been addicted. I could talk to people that have went through suicide. I could talk to people that have been through all of these things. Because you see, Paul didn't say, when in Rome, act like Galatians. He didn't say that when you're around non-believers, act like you are holier than thou. You see, he didn't say that. He said, when in Rome, act like you're in Rome. See, so God did that so when I'm talking to drug dealers and stuff like that, that I can talk to them because I know what's up. I know the lingo. I know how it all goes. But see, I can also go and I can talk to people that have been in the church for years and years and years because I grew up in the church, so I know the things to say. Not that I want to be Christian in my talk, but I don't want to disrespect them to the fact that I can actually get through to their brains. Are you guys following me here? You see, it's not about human traditions, because what's tradition going to give you? Nothing. It gives you empty feelings Monday through Saturday. That's what tradition does. It gives you nothing. But you see, when it becomes a relationship and not a religion, then it fills us to the point where we have something on Monday when we wake up, and we have something on Tuesday when we wake up. We have something on Wednesday, and it continues throughout the rest of the week. Now, sometimes, yeah, it might dwindle, but that's why we come back, okay? And if it's dwindled by Wednesday, guess what? We have Bible study right up there. We have a teen group right here. If it's dwindled by Wednesday, you can get a little bit more. It's not a tradition. Think about all the traditions in your mind that the church has made, and please erase them. Please erase them. Because they're not okay. I don't want the veil over your eyes that this is what it's supposed to be. When we first came here, it was tradition to do what? Two hymns, sit down. Right? Yes? Two hymns, sit down. Tradition. Did that get us anywhere? No. I've talked to some of you, and you said that worship was just, what is worship? We get up, we sing two hymns, we sit down. Some of them are nice, and they're a little upbeat, and we'll clap our hands. But that's about all that we get. You see, when we get past the tradition thing and we start getting into actual relationship with him and we start letting the Holy Spirit kind of do some crazy things inside of us, then it's not tradition anymore. Then it's just worship. You see, that's just the way that it's supposed to be. We can do old songs. We can do new songs. But the thing is that it's all about worship. It's just not about tradition. Thank you, Grace. 1 Timothy chapter 6. But you, man of God, flee from all this. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses. Flee from all of this. To me right here, this is flee from your tradition. Flee from your religion. Pursue righteousness, godliness. What is righteous? Let's just look at Jesus' life. His life was righteous. His life was godly. His life was full of faith and full of love. He endured to the end. He didn't give up, but he was yet still gentle. Even when he was honest, it was still gentle. You see, right there, it doesn't say that you pursue tradition. It doesn't say that you pursue a complete separation from the sin of this world, that those people are disgusting and nasty and everything else. And I don't even want them to touch my shoes. I mean, I don't even want to walk on the same street that they do. Sinners can walk on that side, and I will walk on this side because I'm righteous, and I don't want to be part of your filth. It doesn't say that. When I look at Jesus' life, who do you hang out with? Prostitutes. Tax collectors, he hung out with some nasty people at the time. But guess what? Man, he was gentle to them. He loved them. He had full faith. You see, he knew to love people and to love the dirty and disgusting meant that we had to jump in right in with them. Because we knew that we were okay. Right? You knew that you're all right. No temptation is going to overtake you. God gives you a way out. Now, if you get in too deep and all of a sudden you used to have a problem with pornography, I don't think that God's going to be calling you into the strip bar. Just my thought. If you were a complete alcoholic, sometimes I don't think he's going to call you to sit at the bar with your buddies. Okay? Me being a drug addict, I don't think he's going to invite me to be in the circle passing around the weed. He might call me to talk to the addict. He might call me to talk to the one that's selling it. But you see, there's a separation there that's okay. But those people still need Jesus. But you see, a religious man would fall back into the temptation, because it's all about tradition. It's not about relationship. You see, religious men, we don't go through conviction because we think we're okay, when actually we realize that we are still dirty, disgusting sinners that needs a Savior. If you guys haven't felt conviction in a long time, I'd probably look at my relationship with Jesus, because he's constantly trying to make us better. That's right. This is hard to swallow. You guys can take big swallows. Mark chapter 7. He replied, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites, as it is written. You see, who said this? Jesus? Guess who he said it to? The religious people. The Pharisees, those that thought that they were religious but had no relationship. If Jesus was saying this today, guess who he'd be saying it to? Us. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teaching are but rules taught by men. Anybody ever had the rules given to you when you came to church? Things you could not do, things that you can do. Yes? Believe me, I have. I have. You have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to the traditions of men. Jesus said this here. Again, I'm not making this stuff up, guys. Men, we can't be religious. You can't just come here because it's the right thing to do on Sunday morning. It's not going to get you anywhere. I'm sad to say that there's probably a lot of people in hell right now thinking, I was at church every Sunday. What didn't I do? I wore my best. I didn't cuss on Sundays. I tried not to drink or smoke and yell at people. I was really good on Sundays. Well, because it became a tradition thing. That's not all right. That is not okay. Guess what? If you miss a Sunday here, it's okay. If you got something going on, it's all right. God still loves you. I hope it's not something major. If it is and we need to help, just let us know. But it's all right, because it's not a tradition. We don't keep chart of who's here. We don't give you stars when you walk through the door. It's not a tradition thing. Matthew chapter 21. Right here's the final question. Which of these are you? Be honest with yourself. What do you think? Again, Jesus speaking. Have you noticed a lot of the stuff I'm pulling out is what Jesus said? Because I just want to make sure you guys realize that it's not Paul or somebody else, that Jesus is actually saying this stuff. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, son, go and work today in the vineyard. Son said, I will not. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son, said the same thing. That son answered, I will. But he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted? You see, what that means is that, you see the second, yes, that's fine. The first, they answered. Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. He said this to the religious people. Could you imagine how these Pharisees I can't even be a part of them. They don't even look at them. And Jesus said, guess what? Those nasty, nasty people over there, they're going to enter heaven before you do. But you see, when he talked to those two brothers, what that comes down to is that the first one, that's somebody, the first son, he's somebody that he knew that it wasn't a religion. He realized it wasn't a tradition. The second son, it was a religion for him. Because he gave the right answer to his dad's face. He said, yeah, I'll go. I want to look good in front of you. But then he just didn't do anything. He didn't do the work. Where the first son said, no. No. But then what happened later on? He went out and did it because he realized that it's not about what man says that you should do. Sometimes it's not even about what your pastor says that you should do, because we've gotten it wrong a lot. Okay? For years, I was preached the wrong stuff. I was taught the wrong stuff. This is how you should look. When you look this way, you will be great, and God will love you. Well, guess what? I looked that way, and I became a drug addict. I became an alcoholic. I had sex with women. I did a lot of stuff that I wasn't supposed to do. And I looked great. But then all of a sudden, one point in my life, it snapped. And guess what I look like? I look like what was on the inside. Got 18 piercings, had an 8-inch mohawk, getting tattoos and everything else. I made sure I was the ugliest guy that you would look at. Okay? When you saw me, you thought I was a freak. That was the bottom line. My outside looked like my inside. Because I had followed this list that some guy had made up. When finally God tugged at my heart and said, man, it's not about that list. Yeah, there's a lot of things on there that I don't want you to do. But let me fix that. Don't let some guy standing up there telling you what you should and should not do fix it. Let me fix that stuff. Let me come inside and start to clean you up a little bit. Remember when we talked about a couple weeks ago, when we take a drink of water, we don't tell the water where to go. It just goes where it needs to go. That's what Jesus is saying. If you let me in, guess what? I'm going to go and I'm going to start fixing some stuff that needs to be fixed. Then the next time that you take a drink, I might go somewhere else and start fixing something there. And then the next time you take a drink, guess what? I'm going to go somewhere else and start fixing something there. That's not tradition. That's not religion. I want to make sure that we're the ones, because most of us are under the classification of tax collector and prostitute. Okay? I'm not saying that you're a prostitute, but we are under that level of sin and everything else. That's where we fall. I want to make sure that we're the ones going in. That we're not the ones saying, Lord, Lord. That we're the ones that he's going, well done. Man, good job. Guess what? Come on in. Come on in. Because not only did I see the things that you did, but you also knew me. You had a relationship with me. You did the things that I wanted you to do, not what you thought you should do. Because if we would go back to that scripture, what it talked about was things that really looked impressive to everybody else. Casting out demons. Man, if I did that to somebody, you guys would think I was, whoo, something special, right? We see churches of people that are like that. Some of them are on television. People think, oh, man, that guy, he is righteous. I'm going to follow him. If I did those kind of things, it would be for what? For you guys. Sometimes it's hard to get to the point where, especially as a pastor, and that's why pastors, we need prayer. Because Satan wants nothing more than for us to get big heads and to think that we're doing something great. Because I'm not doing nothing. Okay, I'm just saying what he wants me to say. That's it. And that's the bottom line of what it is. And every pastor should, I pray that they should feel that way. But we continue to need your prayers. You need to be praying for pastors constantly. I'm just going to throw that out there. That's a side note. But please do. Because I don't want to become religious. I don't want to become the tradition. I want to make sure that we have a relationship. Make sure that you have a relationship. Because if you want to be a real man, have a relationship with Jesus. That's it. That relationship might start real small with, hi, how are you? I don't know you. You know me, but I don't know you. That's how the relationship has to start. And then we start giving a little bit, and he starts healing a little bit. We give some more, and he starts healing a little bit. Take a drink of him in this morning. Guys, stand up and actually do something. Be a real man. Some of you have followed these traditions for years. That's wonderful. But let's make sure that you got a relationship. Let's make sure that when we get up there, he's going to go, all right, good job, not depart from me. You doer of wickedness, you evil doer, get away from me. Make the choice this morning. It's really easy. It's not difficult. I'm glad I don't serve a difficult God. That he made it real easy for us to come to know who he was. He said, I'm going to do one thing for you. I'm going to do one amazing thing for you. I'm going to send my son. He's going to be sinless. He's going to take your sin. He's going to take the penalty of that sin. He's going to die for you. He's then going to get the keys of hell. He's going to come back to life. And he's going to give you the chance to do the same thing. That, yeah, we're going to die. Guess what? You're going to die physically. But you're going to come back to life, and it's going to be something great. It's going to be something amazing. He just says, believe in him, accept him, receive him, live a life for him, love him, have a real relationship. A real relationship is when struggles come and you can talk honestly to the other person. When struggles come, you go, Jesus, why are you doing this, man? Why is this going on? thought you were going to be with me. And he's still on the other side going, yeah, I am with you. Relax, we'll get through it. That's a real relationship. So do you have a relationship with God, or you just have a religion with this building? Do you like tradition, or do you like relationship? Do you just want to stay the same and believe that maybe I don't know what I'm talking about? And just think, nope, I'll mark off my checklist every day of great things that I have done. And just when I get there, I know that God's going to let me in because I'm a good guy. I'm a good person. Sorry, it doesn't work that way. So do it now. Make the choice now. It's really easy. We're going to pray. You can make the choice where you're sitting down. You can stand up. You can come forward. Do whatever you want to do. It doesn't have to be something big, something amazing. But I'll tell you what, even as small as it is, no matter how you do it, it's life-changing. When you repent of your sins, when you stop wanting to sin, when you stop wanting to do this nasty and disgusting and evil stuff, when you confess those things that you've done and he starts to clean you up, and then finally when you receive him in, it is life-changing. It is life-changing. Let's pray. You know, Father, as we come to you this morning and as you have dealt with my heart on all this stuff for days now, Father, I pray that if it was one person that needed it, that they would listen and that they would be obedient to what you want them to do. God, they might not even know what they're doing. They might not even know who exactly they're talking to, but they know that they need somebody. They know that they need help in something. And Father, I pray that they would run to you. That they would finally realize that they need you because they can't do it on their own. And Father, we know that you're obedient to what you said. That if they open up the door to their heart, if they truly receive you in, if they just make that choice, that you will come in. That you will be part of them. And that you will start a lifelong process of drawing them closer to you, of transforming them into what you want them to be. Father, we thank you for that. Father, I want to give you glory for everything that you've done. For some of the men that I know around here, some of the men that I know in my life, some of those great examples that you have set before me. Those wonderful clouds of witnesses that actually do it the way that it's supposed to be done. That don't base it on a tradition. That they base it on a relationship, a real relationship with you, Father. I thank you for that. Father, we give you praise. And I pray that when we leave here, that these men are real men. That when we leave here, that they can hold their shoulders back and truly know that they have become the man that you wanted them to become. The father that you want them to be. The husband that you want them to be. The friend that you want them to be. The example that you want them to be. God, we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. You are dismissed.